heartfelt apologies from Sam Frost, who is retained at work, and Andrew Gardner for the reason I can't remember. I'm sure it's incredibly. First item then is the minutes of the previous meeting, on the 3rd of December. So I'm happy with those, send those as correct.
Yeah.
Item 2 then is our code of conduct, declarations of interest. Members of the subcommittee asked if they have any personal purchase interest.
Chair, I'm struggling to make a tenuous link between my role as Magenta, non-executive director of Magenta, but I suppose in some circumstances people may perceive that, but I think it's so distant that we'll declare a personal interest rather than a traditional interest.
Yeah, I think at the moment, because we're not making any decisions, all we're doing is
So we're going to discuss the top of the page for now, I think. We received an email from Steve, who's been researching and stuff. This relates to two policy CSS. He did it, Steve.
Yes.
Yeah. I think what I wasn't entirely clear about, whether it was the policies in the box, the requirements for CS30, or whether it was the commentary below that you had in your hand. So, do you want to speak to your...
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, basically, I would like to see the word sort of, you know, active travel and connectivity in the actual policy, but in the description, a sort of formal word that sort of matches within the email, which I can sort of read out if you wish, what it's actually said.
Has everyone been able to say, appreciate your
audience.
Yeah. Just leave me there for a second. I'll be on the end because obviously he's the draft man.
Yeah.
Of the policies and take a view.
Okay, thanks for the copy of the email, the email there, Steve. I think the text is around some of the supporting text rather than the policy and the Bristol. It's the Bristol Core Strategy is the one I'm seeing that was adopted in 2009, and they're doing a review at the moment to propose it to keep. No problem bringing some sort of link into to active travel. Point 2 in the CS30 policy that you've got before you there is about protecting and enhancing rights of way and access to local facilities and so on. And we would bring in, say it was an application for housing estates, we'd be bringing the transport policies in there where we'll catch the cycling, the walking, etc. Not a problem to insert some sort of link that makes it clear that the green spaces can also contribute to active travel for heaven's sake, like the Wirral Way, for instance, and so on. I cycle over the park. Central Park, even in the nice little forties. It's the kind of thing that we want to try and achieve.
Yeah, that's how we do it. There was nothing really untoward what's already been written. I just would like to see a bit more descriptive of what we're actually talking about, really, so there's no confusion for the future.
Yeah, I think the language in there is a little bit more members of the audience possibly not understand the text that we're looking at, okay, which came from an email from you. So we're just going to run through that, and I think while we're generally happy with it, and we can presumably hopefully leave it with that detail, incorporates as is each fit, given the language used. But we'll come back to where we're going to go in the future of these things that we go after that. So just...
So basically, the course strategy describes green infrastructure as the network of green assets that will work together to support sustainability and quality of life within and around Bristol. These networks bring many social, economic and developmental benefits aimed at connectivity to green infrastructure, so include walking and cycling routes, public rights of way, accessible river corridors and green and creates an urban environment that encourages physical activity as part of everyday life. Furthermore, connectivity for wildlife is considered. It does go on to that a little bit because we have the first paragraph, which was what made the chest to it.
It's my understanding, Chair, that most of those words are in our policy and core strategy, as Eddie says. But I think as you review, you have to change the type of words that you use, and the new words that come into the climate and air sea vocabulary, and I think that covers some of those type of words. So it's a new modern plan, it should be using the new modern terminology that people are using. I don't think it's contrary to anything we're saying, I just think it's probably a better way of saying it. Oh, by the way, Bristol.
Yes, tell people I'm very keen to have this nice in Bristol. We'll give that now, Geoffrey.
Just as a detail, Steve stumbled in his reading there, and I can see why. It says accessible river corridors and green and create an urban environment. Do they mean and greens or green spaces, or is there something wrong there?
I can't help feeling we're helping Bristol a little bit too much. Before we leave CSA, then, I was looking at point one in the main policy, which talked about soft landscape, and maybe they might be repeated elsewhere. And again, just bring it to bear, if you like, our experience on planning committee dealing with plan applications. Very often we don't see the details of soft landscape, and very often the condition around it is, if you like, in agreement with council officers. So we have no feel directly for what the landscaping plan would be for any sort of development. There was one a number of weeks ago in Hedgehog where there was clearly going to be some loss of tree cover. And we were basically, I was saying to the developer, who was in the audience, so would you mind putting a few trees back? And one just wonders whether that's the level of power that we want over it, whether we should be, in the same way that we ask for more detail. Whether we should actually be asking for soft landscape plans that are visible already on the website as part of the documentation, that we ask for. Too often I do feel that to be agreed later is not quite what we're after. If we're after developments that have an amenity and are pleasing, if you like, to the eye, soft landscape can be quite I can think of a number of developments that they put up the odd spreading bush in and then they died and it's too late, and others where the plans say a tree is to be retained and then chopping down and down. And it turns out they have got no powers to prevent that. In any case, I just wonder whether if it was conditioned more robustly at the decision stage, whether we'd be able to do something about that. So I don't know whether that fits into the policy or whether it just fits into the if you like the bureaucracy of what you've got to provide when you register an application.
Outline.
financially by increasing tree cover?
Yes. Which may or may not go for consultation in the weekend. We don't want to jump any gun between the regular leaders in response. It's not going to be, particularly with partial consultation, but yes, it's going to be that list. Any further points you'll see us
just watch out. Just a small one from yourself in terms of one and two, if you like, and where it affects schools. So, in other words, round schools, this was more than time, a lot of schools have got a hedge all the way down schools which protect them from the traffic and the fires come off it. I just wonder, could we make that as a part of the policy, which basically says around schools, hedges should provide, or schools should endeavour to do it.
Okay. We will link it back to the policy that I've just noted about the landscaping within the developments and hedge rows.
I think it's still to make policies retrospective in that sense, but obviously if they're not paid for the whole new school or what have you, then a form part of your soft landscape, yes. Which as I think is the case,
I think the point George's trying to make, I'll paraphrase, but where modern thinking is running is that if your, say, premises were adjacent to a busy thoroughfare, then hedges in themselves act as a catch of particulates, etc. So, for example, if we were building, say, an application for a large estate, which one side of the estate supported a busy main road, say, the A41, for example, we could think ahead of the game and talk about sort of by hedges as part of an overall strategy. I think that's where that sort of policy is leading. So as we develop the local plan and the tree strategy and all those other things coming together, it's just where putting in the officer's mind that that's where we would like to be heading policy. We'd like to be ahead of the game rather than waiting for someone to say, well, you should have built a hedge in front of the house. Well, why don't we build a hedge in front of the house? So, you know, everyone needs protection from particulates and stuff like that. So not just your children in schools, but general population.
So I mean, the point of the policy is that it needs to be robust enough to be able to threaten with refusal of the application on the basis of the other. But you know, that's it needs to be robust enough to be able to that. I mean, obviously all these things are subject to balance, but I mean, if you want to have, then
there's a if you write something in the general policy, or encourage current environmental thinking, or you know, best environmental practice should be adopted where possible. That then gives you a lead in to say, well, you know, the developers have got that in mind. If you don't put things in the developers' mind, you're not going to pay extra for hedges, are you? But if you say, well, you're taking the environmental box of this application, then you know, that is also being proactive on considering that. That's it.
Yes, definitely.
I think just picking up on what Councillor Banks has said, we can and we should be very proactive in these things. So we can do, you know, design guides and other things like that that are positive statements of what these places should look like in terms of their design and the quality and the things that we want to see, you know, for the benefit not just of today's generation but for future as well. And we all really have policies in here that we can link that to. The quality of place by design and how we manage that. That's not just in terms of landscape, of course, it's in terms of good quality design that designs out things like antisocial behaviour and those types of factors as well. And so, you know, my suggestion for you would be, in addition to the policies, we have a series of specific design guides that look at the detail of this and say to developers, this is what we are expecting as a council in terms of the quality of development for the future of the place that will, you know, and
commissions with roofy trees in the programme. I think that'd be really useful. To be around no schools and no large developments.
I think the message here, it's always got to be a balance on that appears in the policy itself, in the commentary or in other guidance and the SPVs that come along. Rely on the professionals to ensure that the sentiment is in the right place. Can I just, I think it was a question that was raised by Steve weeks ago. I think, whenever we refer to other policies within a policy, so this CS 30 refers back to CS 4 and CS 11. Which on its own don't tell me what it's referring to. I just wonder whether you can put the title in as well, so that we get a feel for what it is, the general area that you send us back to, rather than having to dig out CS 4 and might not be at the front of our minds.
Yeah.
Seriously.
Yeah. There's that, because we're basically getting into stage where we're going to be able to I don't think so. If there's a historical reference or a policy that needs to be fixed, so we just, once that doesn't seem like it, we just hope that happens.
So no doubt they'll open in a new window on new tabs. Okay, so we're all happy then with CS 30. Moving that through to CS 31, recreational land and buildings. So we're back into the territory of XXX. So we get to try and what we want. I have noted, as I've glanced through the proposed local plan for consultation, that there are actually numbers in there for some of these distances and hectares. So I wasn't sure why those numbers were missing out of here, even if they change, because I think that's the discussion we probably need to have now. Can we look at these almost as a line by line? So what we're saying is we're going to regulate the provision of recreational open space on the basis of minimum standards, and these are going to be minimum standards. So we want accessible open space, i.e. so many hectares, 20,000 per people. So we currently have that box that's currently there. How many hectares would that be currently there?
It's 2.5.
Okay, so we're after 2.5 hectares for every 1,000 people. Now, what's the basis then of that, apart from the historical? That's what we've always asked for. And should we be asking, is it reasonable to ask for more? Or is that entirely unreasonable, or is it waiting for something else? So one of our options so far was these minimum standards.
Can I sort of introduce it and see where the
okay.
goes? Long-standing standards in the UDP. We brought them forward in the strategy in 2012 based on an updated assessment. And the position we're in at the moment is we have a consultant's report before, but it's not yet been agreed. And we're seeking to get that published when the consultation goes at the end of this month. There are different figures in there, but we're in discussions over those. Some are better, some are worse. But there's, at this stage of the game, we don't have anything really that we can put on the table. If it would help, once we finalise the report, and then have that agreed with the consultants. There's not a problem for members having that before the consultation starts.
Do you want to come in now, Steve?
Well, I think think the CSA's what I'm looking at is looking at just to get it down there. We're looking at the CSA's what I'm looking at here. I think it talks about women in general, doesn't it? Now, clearly, if the local plan consultation, they're talking about intensification and stuff like that. My view is that we would need to be as flexible as that following the results of the consultation, because you know, you could argue that okay, the will is saying X amount for X amount of population, but in a particular area it might not meet that criteria, and the application may sort of, people may say, well, the application is going against the overall policy. So I just think we need to be careful of putting half past figures in at any point until the final, all the pieces of work have been done and the consultation results have come back in. Is that making sense to members?
It might be something
we actually generally accept that the urban areas will be, there is an intensification of some of the urban areas if we go down the route. Overall, on Will, that will result in there will be places, but there's not many kids from North End who want to go and play a thought enough, if you know what I mean. So you have to think about it in those sort of terms as well. So I just think it's worth sort of putting the market down, but making sure we don't make it more difficult for us in the future.
I agree with that. It's clearly still subject to consultants looking at it and weighing it up and seeing, you know, how we compare with other thousands. I think it is right about the market, you know, that it's not just certain areas and Wirral that are entitled to green space. I think that's got to be a market. And there are issues about intensification, and the density study is ongoing. You know, I understand the drafts of those, or our understanding of it is going to be published alongside the rest of the consultation. And it does strike me that, having heard what Eddie said, that some of these issues will have to come back to us, so that we can take that. But then, you know, the market will need to be, you know, from my point of view, everyone, you know, kids in the North End are just as entitled to play on a piece of green space as kids in Poylake, and, you know, I see
he's got common sense
on that. But we will need to understand what density means, and what intensification means, and I think this is the best form, frankly, for looking at that. So whilst we have this as a policy in front of us, I'm not sure we fully understand what it means for the communities that were certainly to the east of the world at the moment. You know, I mean, in terms of the drafting of it, you know, I'm comfortable with it, so long as in due course we get the opportunity to be able to understand precisely what it means in terms of how much space we'll have for kids to kick the ball about, how far they'll have to walk, you know, to get there, and where that sits in with the rest of it. These are the things that are going to have to be balanced, as Steve's pointed out, in the round as part of the consultation. So I'm grateful for that. Once we went through these, I think I just wanted to say to the committee, I just wanted to take stock of where we are and what we've left, if you like, in the base that we would quite like to see again. Is that okay for now, Stuart?
Yeah, okay, thanks, Stuart. I think we mustn't also forget that the community's got the ability to designate the green space.
As part of the consultation.
To protect the green spaces, particularly in the urban areas. What we're going to see within CSP, as long as any mention of ongoing costs, surely if there's large developments, surely there's an opportunity there for developers to contribute towards the ongoing costs of their operational spaces.
Just to mention two things maybe for members to think about, because I think Stuart's right, this policy does need to come back once the local plan has been consulted on and you begin to see what the outcome of that is.
houses, then it will probably pave on some roads, which will also fall to public expense. So, you know, there's no reason why a state that comes with pavements and roads shouldn't also come with recreational space. There's also maintained on public expense. It's the same idea as, you know, they both have a role. Roads have as much light, I guess, to be there as open space. But yeah, we probably do need to think about the maintenance of all of it. Yes, sure.
Yeah, there's a difference between roads and, you know, open space. There's statutory responsibilities to, you know, maintain roads in safe condition. We've not got a statutory responsibility, you know, to go across the villages for and so to speak. So I would welcome if we could, you know, create some policies around the number of maintenance side things, because if you're not from Weston, you know, another really nice new area. That people have been to, and then over the years it deteriorates because we're not able to keep on top of the news.
Thank you, Chair. Eddie's filled in that first blank clause of 2.5. I'm sorry, I first read it
at
2.4. Sorry, 2.4.
That's the existing, not the proposed.
So that's from 2012.
Yeah.
I just have in the back of my mind, when I was first on the council, presumably this was from the 2000 version, that it wasn't expressed in terms of areas, it was expressed in terms of units. Because I seem to remember opposing a planning application where there was an estate of, I don't know, 34 houses or something like that. Because it was more than 30 houses, they had to do this. But if they'd only gone for 29 houses, they'd got away with it, something like that.
We deal with that under the next policy. UDP does have a standard 60 square metres per house over 30 units as the triggers, but that again is up for grabs for what we're talking.
I mean, it's an important one, I think, for us. I said I think it's important, so obviously we've come back on these issues and also the issue of maintenance and quality. Anything further down CS31? CS32 then, recreational open space in new residential developments. Is this one in the same category? Essentially, because we're looking at distances and area.
Just to highlight this policy. Again, I would urge the ability for flexibility. You often get developments that come forward because of constraints of site or whatever. It is basically impossible to comply with that policy, but we often do we not have a commuting sum of money rather than actually building a children's play area. This is about soft play areas, isn't it? I can quote a couple of examples where that's been beneficial to the community, that they didn't actually build the play area where the houses were built, but adjacent to in another publicly acceptable area. So we've just benefited on Thomas Road, the old wreck, from a commuted sum, play area, been upgraded, fantastic. Thousands of people have used it over the summer, and I'm using it as we speak, but not on that as we speak, but during this, even the good weather. So I'm just saying, you know, that wouldn't be overly prescriptive. And I'm not talking in favour of developers where they try to shy away from it. But there are genuine circumstances where it's not suitable, because some people consider a children's play area as a menace as much as it's an advantage to think of the state and the areas we all represent where that happens. So I'm just urging that, you know, there's a degree of understanding and flexibility that the sum of money associated with the play area might be better used not on the site itself, but adjacent to. Does that make sense with the planners?
Yeah.
similar theme to the housing development I referred to earlier. They didn't provide the play area on the site, they provided in the nearest park.
Yes.
And we got an upgraded, very nicely upgraded children's play area. The only trouble was in terms of the children who might have grown up on the housing estate, it was across a busy main road as well as probably beyond the walking distance anyway. So it wasn't really very much use for them. So I don't know how you control that.
There's all by centuries in Prenton, which from the moment you put it in, there's always the kids up, yeah. Always from all around, and you know, it's a long way from houses as well, so kids do have to put some distance to it, but they certainly use it, you know. So if it's in an established recreational space, then it is more likely, I would suggest, to be used. So as Steve suggests, it's a question of balance.
It's a clear balance question.
Yeah, and what it will look like in a new development, because some of the ones we've seen in the past have been right on top of, you know, people's houses, and next thing you've got a petition either not to put it there or to remove the damn thing, which we certainly had in the past. But there are appropriate places for them to go. I think we should be blamed for that in general. Yeah. CS Designated, Biodiversity, Geodiversity. I didn't have some particular points, any points?
Well, there's reference in this to, over the page, effect on a European site. Well, this will be called European sites by the time this is published.
It was still in your geographical. It didn't say geo, much as some people may wish it otherwise, we are still in the continent of Europe. So, and if the site is of continental interest, then it remains of continental interest, much as it may have annoyed some people.
Well, sorry, but
I'm not
going to mention the beam here, but I think during the process there were certain pieces of legislation that were to protect these type of issues were enshrined automatically into English law, am I correct? And I think these were normally the issues that were built very early doors. So but the terminology changes or not, the effect of the protection should be there, thankfully.
Absolutely. I mean, things are contact European interest, and you know, there's a couple of sites that are likely within the Liverpool City region to be well heritage interest. So you know, we may very well, exactly, we may very well wish we weren't on this planet, sometimes we do, but we are, so
the second policy within this, assess the likely expected impact of development on the features of biodiversity or geodiversity identified, and I think sort of going on to other things, that I might believe that we have got some kind of a schedule somewhere that says where these important places are for biodiversity and geodiversity. So,
I mean, I would just say yes, but anyone knows exactly where it
is. Well, the answer is yes. These are set under international law, the triple SSIs, and then your local sites, we've got them.
When the maps go online, the land use, we will see, if you like, the land use designations. So which you'll probably be familiar with from the UDP mapping to the top on that. So that will be there, and those sites will remain the same. Just on the idea of the list, the UDP used to have a policy the grid action list site. So do we not need to go down that route with the local plan, or is the proposal map sufficient to meet that? I have no wish to duplicate anything or introduce pages where it's not quite
consistent.
Possibly.
two, the identified assets capital, the opening says is applicant can demonstrate that the identified assets can be incorporated and enhanced within the layout of the development without avoiding any harm or loss to biodiversity or geodiversity. There's no double negative.
It's report what I wrote.
without avoiding any harm.
Do nothing.
I don't think we're trying to avoid any harm, we're trying to avoid harm or without harming, I mean.
Yeah, we can think of that.
We'll put that into structure. See whether it agrees with you or not. If this is a split infinitive, I'm not accepting it.
That's it. Tourist development within XXS for the DS Street Natura 2000 site. Reading the, I think it's a final appendix to the plan we published last week for the consultation, there's masses of stuff being done there on all the various implications for the various European designations. And what I got out at the end of it, basically the same, is don't build any houses anywhere near the Wirral coast because people are going to walk more dogs on the beach. That's basically what the conclusion was. And how we're going to prevent them causing harm by walking more dogs on the beach. So I think we're sort of half getting to it there.
Unfortunately, I haven't reached appendix. I'm not going to embarrass myself to say what page before. But let me toss that over to
I'll just say something first of all on this point, because it is one that I've raised with appropriate members, and that is the pressures that there are, not just on European designated site, but on our beaches and coastline from new development. So to give you an example, we recently approved a planning application in Birkenhead for a series of residential houses. As part of that, we had to assess what the recreational impact was going to be on people who live there. The coast either for dog walking or for other activities, because across the Liverpool city, the pressures on the beaches and those pressures are increasing all of the time, and there has to be some way of managing that effectively. And it's a balance between the new development and the protection of the coast and the environment and the recreational pressures, not just the European sites. So there's some work going on at Liverpool city region level at the moment that's being promoted by people like Natural England. And doing studies and collecting evidence and looking at these impacts and seeing what they could mean. And they are moving in the direction, if the evidence supports it, that actually levying a tariff